Jesus at the center of it all.
Hallelujah. It's so good to stand before all of you again to share with you what the Lord has put in my heart. It's been a very busy week, but every time as I sit down and think a little bit about what I'm going to share on Sunday morning, the Lord just keep on revealing the truth in His Word. But before that, I just want to just connect with last Sunday. How many of you were here last Sunday? Okay, quite a lot of you. But some of you were not here. And so we want to read this verse together, okay? Can we read this theme verse together? Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. One more time. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. We said last Sunday that, you know, it is time for us to get out of our comfort zone, to get out of our where we are comfortable, where we are just sitting down or lying down. Maybe we have good reasons to be down because life has been cruel to us. Life has not been fair to us. Maybe we are just so busy and so tired. We have good reason to be down. We just want to rest and rest on. We don't want to get involved anymore. Maybe we have good reason to be down because we have not been so well and so on. But I want to say to you this morning that the Lord says to you this year in 2017 to arise, to get out of where you are. Maybe you have been you have been active and so on, but the Lord is also saying to you, you're not lying down, you're already active, working and serving. But the Lord says to you this year too that He wants you to arise so that He can take you to a higher plane that you never imagined that you can be. Just as the Lord has taken Susan to the much higher plane, you know. And so, the message for us in 2017, for all of you, for all of us here, including myself, is the Lord says to us to arise. To arise of what? To shine. To allow the glory of the Lord, the light of the Lord that is inside us. You know, Christ in us is the hope of glory. So inside us, the Spirit of the Lord that is inside us, to arise and to be all over us. Amen? Hallelujah. And when the glory of the Lord is within us, we are the only ones who are benefit. We know we have His joy, we have His peace in us. But when it is risen upon us and all over us, people all around us will then be blessed because we have been blessed. Amen? Hallelujah. So that's where we started last Sunday. But this Sunday, I want us to move on. We want to see ourselves as a church where our church is, we are a church that is beyond the walls, beyond the physical walls of the church, beyond our emotional walls. That sometimes, you know, just as Joanna said, every time I go to the fellowship hall, I know exactly who sits where to. I know who sits with who to. And then there could be some people who may be new there, but they always will sit alone and nobody talks to them. And they themselves, the new people, are in their own walls, but our regular folks are also in their own walls, you know. We don't go beyond our walls. So don't think of the walls here as a physical wall. It could be our emotional walls, it could be our social walls, whatever it is. But the Lord, I believe, in 2017, is calling us to be a church that goes beyond the walls. Amen? And we want to look at this passage of Scripture, Acts chapter 2, to give us an idea what it means for us to be a church that goes beyond the walls. Okay, can we all read this together? Those who accepted His message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. So what's the context of this passage? Very simple. If you have been, you know a little bit about your Bible, you know that Jesus ascended into heaven, and then he told his disciples, the 120 of them, to wait in Jerusalem in the upper room, and then the Holy Spirit will come upon them. And the Holy Spirit indeed, after 10 days of waiting, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak in other tongues, and they were speaking not just gibberish, but tongues that people could understand. And during that time, which was the Feast of the Pentecost, thousands of Jews from all over the world were there. And they heard, Jews from different nations, and they heard these Jerusalem Jews speaking the language that they were familiar with. They were speaking different 15 other languages, and they were all surprised. And so Peter stood up and spoke a message to explain what's happening. He said, these men are not drunk, but instead this is the fulfillment of prophecies of the Old Testament, where God says that he will bring down his spirit upon men, and so that they will dream dreams and speak in other tongues. And so, and then because of Peter's message, 3,000 of them came to know the Lord that day, and the church began to grow. And we want to see what's happening with the church at that time. During this, I mean, they couldn't be more than just a couple of months old. And so we want to see how this can be, what lessons we can learn from the early church, the earliest church, so that we too can be a church like them. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Okay, I want to say this as a statement first, that God's original design for the church is that we are not supposed to be in a building like this, you know? We are supposed to go beyond these walls, beyond the physical walls of the church, beyond the emotional walls of the church, beyond the social walls of the church. We are supposed to go beyond the walls. And some months ago, I think end of November, I said that how Jesus is our example and our inspiration. How is he our example and inspiration? When you look at the ministry of Jesus, how is he an example for us? Jesus, I said, did not come to give us a ministry. Some of us think that we are already a ministry. Pastor, I already got a ministry. But I want to remind you that Jesus came to make us ministers of the gospel. Amen? We are not just to be walled up in one ministry. We are in the video ministry. Sharing the good news. That one is pastor job, you know? Oh, I'm in this feeding the poor, sharing the good news is somebody else's job. No, Jesus didn't come to give us a ministry. Yes, we can develop a ministry, but Jesus came to make us ministers of the gospel. Amen? You know, we are all called ambassadors of Christ. We are all called to be ministers of the gospel. And Jesus did not just have a ministry. If you look at the life of Jesus, everywhere he went, he had a life that ministered all the time. Amen. Whether he was resting, whether he was feasting with the tax collectors, whether he was being questioned by the Pharisees, he had a life that ministered life all the time. Amen. Hallelujah. I hope that sinks down into you. If that is Jesus, then all of us should be like that too. Amen? All of us can be like that too. Why? Because the very spirit that was in Jesus is also in us. Hallelujah. So Acts chapter 2, verse 41 to 47, gives us an idea of a community that went beyond the walls. Here was the earliest church. How many of you have been Christians for more than 1 year? Put up your hands, please. How many of you have been Christians for more than 1 year? Wow, quite a lot of you. How many of you have been Christians for 6 months and less? Don't see many. Okay. How many of you have been Christians for the last 3 months? Okay, so all of us have been Christians for quite a long time. Okay? Longer than this early church has been. So we want to go back there to learn from them and see, is there something that we are missing or not? So in this community, in this early church community, we find three things about them. First of all, they were very engrossed with certain things. You know, they were putting their whole heart into it, very engrossed in certain things. And then, can somebody help me with a slide? Okay, they also have had certain experiences about what it means to be a community. And then we see because they were engrossed, because they had certain experiences, God extended the community. Would you want to be part of that community? Would you want to see how this has happened? Okay, let's move on. Huh? We read just now, they said they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and the breaking of bread and to prayer. You know, the Bible is very clear here. It says they devoted themselves. They devoted themselves. Not somebody asked them to do so. Not that somebody forced them to do so. But they devoted themselves. The word devoted is a very big word. It's a very strong word. That means they get very engrossed. They put their whole life into this matter. And what did they put their whole life into? They made that very deliberate choice. How did they begin to put their whole life into something? They made that choice. They made that choice that they want to be committed and passionate about these four things that we read about. Four things that they read about. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. They devoted themselves to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. What does that mean for us? Well, the apostles' teaching. It's a surprise, isn't it? You would think that they would be all talking about other things, but they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Now, in the church, sometimes we always get this different things coming. So as pastor, I'm quite enjoying it sometimes because people come and say, "Pastor, your church, every day you preach and preach and preach only, you know, all word and word and word, word, word. We got enough of word. We want the Spirit, you know. We want more of the Spirit, you know." I get this sort of thing. Then sometimes when we have certain meetings and there's a manifestation, I say, "Pastor, you are going wrong, too much of the Spirit now, please, we got to go back to the word again, you know." And it's always like that. Word or Spirit, you know. And I think sometimes when we try to say a church is like this or should be like this, then sometimes we miss out what God wants to do in our church. I want to say to you, it's neither word or spirit. We need both word and spirit. Okay? We need both the word and we need the Holy Spirit working in our lives. And the Holy Spirit is already in us, and all we need to do is arise and allow it to shine out of us. Amen? And I want to say this to all of us here too. We need to be hungry for the word, okay? The word is hunger. You know, sometimes we take it so, you know, we are so complacent about everything already. We say, we know God loves us, so what is there to study the Bible anymore? But I want to say to you, every day we need to study the Word. Every day we need to read the Word. Every day we need to have that hunger for the Word. You know, that day I was having lunch and somebody ordered foie gras, and said, "Okay, now let's try it." Then I said, "Well, fortunately my children are not here. If they are here, they said, 'Dad, you cannot eat that.'" Because you know how they get foie gras? They force feed the goose, you know. They pump food into the goose. You know, you see in the pictures, they put a pipe inside, just pump, until the liver get enlarged. They kill the goose and take out the liver. Then you pay a few hundred dollars for that small piece of liver. You know, and that's what it is. But I want to say to us, we don't want to force feed anybody. But we want all of us to have that hunger deep inside us for the word. Amen. We need to have that. The early church was devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. And while we are hungry for the word, we need to be thirsty for the Spirit. Amen? You know, this last 3 months, I went on a very special diet. No carbo, so no rice, no noodles, no cakes, no bread, nothing at all. But I got to eat a lot of veggie and some meat now and then, okay? And so I know what it means to be hungry. I eat breakfast at 7 o'clock. By 10:30, I'm very hungry. But I cannot eat anything else. So I drink a lot of warm water, fill up the stomach. You know, and I want to say this to you all, okay? So if we all, in what is true in the physical should also be true for us in the spiritual. We need to be hungry for the word, okay? And thirsty for the spirit. Okay, this if we speak in these terms, I hope you understand this. Nobody can force you to eat something if you're not hungry. But if you're hungry, then eat the right things, lah. Don't eat Korean dramas and movies. You know, feed yourself with the right things, lah. Right? If you're thirsty, drink the right thing, lah. You know. Don't drink Coca-Cola all the time. Drink pure water, good for you. You know, so be hungry for the word and thirsty for the spirit. The Lord says that when we drink the water He gives us, out of our innermost being will flow rivers of living water. You know, so give you the same idea again. You know, when the Spirit of the Lord is upon you, the rivers of living water will flow all over you. Amen. Hallelujah. So the word is foundational. That's why even the writer Acts put it right at the beginning, the apostles' teaching. We need to be passionate and committed to the word before we even think about going beyond the walls. Amen? We need to be committed to that. And then, I want to say to you, yesterday we had Lizzie coming to share with us from the word and related to her life experiences about what it means to live in a life of grace. 50, 60 people were there and we were happy. But I wish that 500 of us were there too to listen to her. You know, so the next time we do something like this, I trust more of us will come and be blessed by what different ones that have come to can come and share with us, okay? So what is the apostles' teaching? Very quickly. Oh, I need some help here. What's the apostles' teaching? Peter, in his message, has this to say: Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourself know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him up from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. You see, the apostles right at the beginning preached nothing but Jesus. Amen? Jesus' life, Jesus' death, and his resurrection. What Jesus has done by his life and his death and through his resurrection. So the apostles' teaching was centered around Jesus. Just in case you say, oh, that's our gospel message. No. Acts chapter 4 records for us again. With great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. So the apostles gave witness to what? To the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. Okay? When you talk about the resurrection, you also talk about his life, his death, and his resurrection. Amen? Okay? So with great power, it is when you begin to speak about Jesus, there is great power. Power. Amen? There is great power. The Holy Spirit confirms what you have to say about Jesus with great power. And no, you don't just get great power, you get great grace. Hallelujah! Great power, great grace. All because you speak about Jesus. Amen? Hallelujah. So that's the apostles' teaching. But let's move on. The next thing is, and devoted themselves to fellowship. The word fellowship comes from the word koinonia. Now, many of us, when you think of fellowship, means go to a mama store, have coffee together, eat roti canai, which I cannot take now, sorry. Eat roti canai together, or then some of the more hippie, yuppie guys go to Starbucks, drink coffee there. You know, you know, things like that. We think of fellowship as just eating and drinking. Yeah, that's true. But the word fellowship, koinonia, has a much deeper meaning, much wider meaning. It talks about sharing. It talks about companionship. It talks about being in partnership. So when they say devoted themselves to fellowship, it talks about them devoting themselves to sharing, to being of one mind, of companionship, or being in partnership. It is a supernatural grace that causes us to love each other deeply. It is a grace of God being manifested in our community, in our church, in our lives together. Koinonia, fellowship. You know, nobody else uses fellowship, the word fellowship. No other organization uses the word fellowship. Only in church every day you use. But sometimes when you use, you cheapen the, you know, you downgraded the meaning of the word. But it is actually a supernatural grace that is only possible because of the Holy Spirit working in our lives. See, after Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit has come down, we all know about dunamis, the power for healing and miracles. You know, the Holy Spirit come down. Now we have that great power, that dynamic power that is inside us. When we lay hands on the sick, they become well. When we pray, the Lord answers our prayer. Miracles happen. But sometimes we forget that same Holy Spirit also comes down to knit our hearts together, to bind us together as one family, as one community. Amen? So koinonia, fellowship, has a much bigger meaning, much deeper meaning. It is a grace of that the Spirit pours into our hearts so that while we may not know somebody, you know, before, but yet because we know that he is a brother in Christ, our hearts go out to him to help him. Our hearts go out to him to want to be together with him. Amen? So because of koinonia, then the early church, and so too for all of us, we can be a dynamic, united, and authentic community that will consider the other person more important than ourselves. And this is exactly what the early church did. The early church in Acts chapter 4, the writer of Acts, Luke, records for us that the multitude of those who believed were of one heart and one soul. One heart, one soul. Neither did anyone say that any of the things he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common. You know, they didn't hold what they have only for themselves, but they shared it out. They gave to whoever had need. Okay. So, but the main thing is, it was that koinonia, that the special grace of the Spirit that knitted their hearts into one heart and one soul. So, for a long time, people ask me, say, Pastor, why your church got no members on? I said, I have a problem with people about membership. I said, when we have membership, people want benefits only. True or not? Huh? So I'm a member now. What is my benefit? No. I'm just thinking, one day we're going to come up with something. We have not come to that yet. But we're going to say that we are not members of this church. We are all in koinonia in this church. Yeah, you get me? We are all in partnership in this church. And when you're a partner, you don't talk about benefits anymore, isn't it? You know, when you're a partner of a business, you own part of the business, isn't it? Amen? You're a partner of this church, you own part of this church. And so this is what we want to try and explain to all of us, that we all belong to one another, we all belong to TNCC, we all belong to Jesus, we all also belong to one another. Tell your neighbor, I belong to you. Amen. And you belong to me. Amen. What is the third thing that the church was involved in, was engrossed with, the church that devoted themselves to? It was to the breaking of bread. And during the early church, the breaking of bread was a full meal, you know. Communion was a full meal. They didn't just take bits of biscuits and small little cup of wine. It was a full meal that they enjoyed together. It was a full meal that they shared together. The word communion, you know, we have many different words, Last Supper, communion and different things, breaking of bread. But the word communion means community and union, a community in union. Where do we find our unifying factor? How are we united together? We are united together in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen? So it's when we come together for communion, it's not so much a remembering of what Jesus has done for us. More than just that, it is a reenacting of our participation in the death and resurrection of Jesus. When we take communion together, we say, yes, Jesus, I thank you that just as you died on the cross 2,000 years ago, I also died with you on the cross. My old man died on the cross. And just as you rose again after the third day, I too rose again as a new creation in Christ Jesus. Amen? Hallelujah. And that's what communion is about. Yes, we recall the benefits of his death and resurrection, but we are also in communion, participate in what Jesus has done for us. And I want you to note this, that the early church celebrated communion beyond the walls. Where did they break bread? They break bread from house to house, isn't it? They break bread outside the church. So I want to encourage you, and I know many of you are already doing, that every time we can come together to celebrate the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ and our participation in it. So last night, I was just thinking about it. Last night we were having a wedding dinner, and then they asked whether you want red wine. Actually, I didn't want, but since they poured for me, I drank, Then it reminded me that every time I drink something like this, that Jesus' blood was shed for me. And I thank the Lord for that. I trust that this will be what we do. Every time we eat, we break bread, we can thank the Lord for his life and for his forgiveness for us. Amen? Let's go beyond the walls. Not just don't think that only when we come to church and very solemnly say, then only. No. Every moment of our life can be a celebration of our participation in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Just as a side, I was just thinking through, I've got a funny feeling that God could be a Malaysian also like us. There's a lot of makan in the Bible, a lot of meals in the Bible, And when you see another Malaysian, another China man, he say, "Japar, have you eaten?" It's all about eating, I'm sure all the other Malaysian races also. We actually, when you bring a foreigner here, they get very amazed at the variety of food that we have, the variety of restaurants that we have, and the different places that we can go and eat together. But the Bible is also full of meals, okay? The Bible is also full of meals. And we see that, for example, in the Garden of Eden. When Adam saw the fruit from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, he desired it as good for food, not just good to look at, but he desired as something that he wants to eat too. And so they were tempted together by the devil to partake of the fruit against God's specific instruction. So at the Garden of Eden, the first meal of rebellion was recorded. Okay, we had a meal of rebellion then. But then at the Passover, and Justin talked to us about this morning, it was a remembrance. The Passover meal was to remember how good God was to them. Thousands of years ago, when they were in Egypt, and they celebrated the first Passover, and every year the Jews celebrated it, so that they will remember how God delivered them. But Jesus himself, at the Last Supper, instituted the communion, and it is a meal of redemption. Jesus said, this is my body broken for you. This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. He instituted the Last Supper so that we may be totally, completely free. The Passover was, as Justin has also said, is just a shadow of the real thing. The real thing came when Jesus hung on the cross for us. Amen? So, but what was the last What is one more? Can anybody know? The marriage of the Lamb. One day there will be this wedding feast that we all go to, and it will be a time of rejoicing, a time of celebration. Hallelujah. Just aside, okay? But let's go back into prayer, okay? The fourth thing that they were devoted to was to prayer. And I did quite a lot of work on this. I was just thinking, say, Lord, do you want us to be banging on your door every day to ask for things? No, that's not what you are really teaching. Do you want us to be shouting at the top of our voices so that you can hear us? No. Do you want us to be calling you out so that you will be awoken from your sleep? No, God never neither sleep nor slumber. You know? So, enter prayer. And what is it? I think the English Standard Version have a better translation. Okay, and I checked the Greek. It is end the prayers. That gives you a different viewpoint again. What is the writer of Acts Luke trying to tell us here? The community was devoted, was engrossed to the prayers. See, the early church, the early Christians, diligently observed the stipulated times of prayers at the temple. Every day, the Jews are supposed to pray three times, in the morning, afternoon, and in the evening. On Sabbath day, they pray four times. On Yom Kippur day, they had five prayer times, okay? So, and we are told that the early Christians devoted themselves. They diligently, still, even though they were Christians already, they knew the truth, the reality has come, they still went back to the temple and the temple courts. For example, we will look at this, one of these sermons, in Acts chapter 3, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Peter and John were going towards the temple to participate in the prayer time there. And then a beggar, you know, a disabled beggar asked for alms from him, from them. And Peter looked at him in the eye and said, you know, silver and gold I do not have. By the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. And the man walked and began to dance, you know. And so, what am I saying all this for? I'm saying they devoted themselves. They didn't hide themselves into a holy huddle. Okay? They still went back to where their friends, their relatives, their family were. They still went back to where all the rest of Jerusalem, the Jews in the rest of Jerusalem were. They went back to the temple. They went back to the public places. They went back to where the people were. They didn't hide and build a wall around themselves. Oh, now we are holy Christians. We cannot go out anywhere. No, they went out. They went out to the marketplace. They went out to where the people were. And when they went there, miracles happened there. Amen? Amen. Because they were going to the temple, a miracle happened. A healing happened. And that caused a big stir again. The early church devoted themselves to the prayers, to going to where the crowd was, to going to where their friends were, to going to where the people were, so that at the right time, given the opportunity, they could share Jesus. They could demonstrate the power of the Spirit among these people. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. And that's what it means. They devoted themselves to prayer. Not just that they spent the whole day and night in the church praying a long prayer vigil. No. When they devoted themselves to the prayers, they went out to the marketplace. Amen? And allow the glory of the Lord that was upon them to come upon all the others too. Amen? They arose from a comfortable place where they could have been huddled among themselves, but they went out to the marketplace. Amen? So, it was a community that was engrossed. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to koinonia, to partnership with one another, to the breaking of bread, and not just in the church, but in their homes, and also to the prayers, to the marketplace. And then because they were engrossed in these four things, something happened to them and something happened to everybody else. The Bible records for us, everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. No, they're all filled with awe. Everyone. That means everybody in the temple courts, they were all feel it all. They all saw, they all experienced what was happening. So when we go beyond our walls, the signs and wonders, then when they happen, when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon them, then people will be in awe. Amen? Hallelujah. The wonders and signs were performed beyond the walls, beyond their own safety walls so that nobody persecute them, maybe, or beyond the physical walls at their homes. No, they were out there in the marketplace. Amen? Everyone was filled with awe. I just wanted to say two sentences about this. Nowadays, we make the word awe become, we downgrade the meaning. So somebody do something, say, "Oh, awesome what you did." In the Bible, when they talk awesome, they mean God is at work. God is doing something, or what God has done. That's really awesome. What do you see? A pale shadow of what God has done, okay? So awesome, So in a sense, when God is really at work in our midst, and I trust and I want to believe that this will be so forth in 2017, as different ones of us go into the marketplaces, as different ones of us arise and shine and allow the Spirit of the Lord to come forth, allow the dynamics of God to come forth, there will be a sense of wow. People say, wow. At the same time, they're a little bit afraid. Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, how I mean. But at the same time, they were inspired because they know something good is happening. They know God is working there. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. The other thing that the community experienced was this. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. So koinonia, as I said earlier, it's not communism. You think this is, the early believers were like communism. No, they were together in spirit and soul. Physically, it's impossible for them to be together. But they were together. They were of one mind. They were of one mind. They were one spirit together. So it's not about communism, not about socialism, but really about koinonia, about the fact that they knew they had a common purpose. They knew they have a common destiny. They knew they had a common Lord. Okay, that the Lord has called them to one common task, that is to disciple the whole world. And so they sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Okay, so they saw a need and gave willingly and voluntarily to meet the need. And I'm so glad that in our church here today that I see this so very often, that how people came together to meet needs of different ones. And the Lord is so good. The Lord is working in our lives together and bringing us together as one community, molding and melding us together. I have always told people that it is truly the grace of God that has brought us together as one church. We have people who come from very diverse backgrounds, from Roman Catholics, from very extreme Pentecostalism, from very quiet gospel hollers, and everybody else somewhere in between all this, okay? And so from Methodists, from Baptists, from Anglicans, but yet we come from different traditions, different backgrounds, and yet the Lord has managed to, in His grace, brought us all together with one common purpose, that we all are united together in one mind, in one spirit, and in one soul. Isn't that good? Isn't that good? God has brought us together in a short time of a few years, coming together like this. We didn't try to force down any particular culture into anybody, but the Lord just melted and enabled us to take the best from the different traditions and different groups of people, and so that we can have the best within us. Okay? So we experience what it means to be together. And we have everything in common. They sold property and possession to anyone who had need. And I trust and I hope that this will continue, that as we see need, because these are things that as people see that, people will be attracted to us. Just quickly, I want to close in a while. Every day, they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts and praising God. And this is something that I didn't see for many years and just until just a few days ago. Okay, so where were they? They continued to meet together in the temple courts. Okay, where were they? In the marketplace, isn't it? Temple courts, marketplace. Because that's where everybody else gathered three times a day. And then, of course, you remember how Jesus had to chase out some of the traders from the temple courts and so on. So that was the marketplace. And if you go to Jerusalem today, you see, I can't remember, right, Eastern Wall, Western Wall, Western Wall, nothing there, but on the other side, the Southern Wall side, you'll see a lot of broken down ruins of shops and so on that were there during Jesus' time. You know, so that was where the people were gathered. So when they went beyond the walls, and as they were going to beyond the walls, as they were there, they ministered to people there. They shared when there was opportunities to share. They didn't go around and then shouting, hey, you know. No, I believe that as people had problems, they ministered to people, they shared with them. And so what happened? And then they brought them back to the homes to break bread together and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God. Can you see the pattern? They were outside. When they saw God at work outside, and then they came back within the community, what did they do? They celebrated God's goodness. Amen? They praised God for all that God has done in them, through them, and to the people that they were in contact with. Hallelujah! That's a great thing, isn't it? So, we somehow, over the 2,000 years, somehow we got it a little bit wrong. We expect everything to happen here. You know, a nice program, nice worship, oh, you know, great sermon, you know, people coming out, people being touched by the Lord here and so on. No, that's not the pattern. The pattern is you need to go out. The pattern is the happening things should be outside the church. During in your marketplace, when you're buying vegetables, when you're talking to your doctor, when you are negotiating your deals, when you are just waiting for somebody to see you and you meet somebody along the road, and when you're in the coffee house, you're talking, and that's where all these different things should be happening. And when you minister to people, when you arise and shine and allow the glory of the Lord that is upon you to overflow to others, then they will see also the glory of the Lord. And they say, hey, can I meet some more people like this? And then you bring them to church. Okay? And then you come and give testimony. Amen? Hallelujah. You know, and then they give their testimony. And then we all, when we come together like this, it's really so that we can celebrate God's goodness. We praise God together. Yeah? Amen? And I trust that this will be a pattern for us as a church. You know, the early church was like that. And so now we need to go back to our roots and learn from the early church. Amen? Amen. They went beyond the walls. And therefore, because they went beyond the walls, they can come together to celebrate God's goodness as a community, as a koinonia together. Amen. And enjoying the favor of all the people, and the Lord added to their number daily those who are being saved. How can they enjoy the favor of all the people? Because they were there with the people at their time of need. Amen? They were there with the people at their time of need. Hallelujah. They were there when people had a headache. They were there when people were broke and cannot afford a meal. They were there when people could not walk properly and they helped them to cross the road. You know, they were there demonstrating Jesus in their midst. And therefore, they enjoyed the favor of people. There was a winsome attractiveness there. And I want to believe that in 2017, we as a church, as a community of people, we as a koinonia will also be like this. No amen? Amen. You believe so? Hey, you can be the most attractive people in all of the earth. Amen. Why? Because you have Jesus in you. You have everything that Jesus has in you. You have all the joy of Jesus in you. You have all the peace of Jesus in you. And yet you have the love of Jesus in you. You can have that winsome attractiveness just as the early church had. And therefore, enjoy the favor and goodwill of all. When people people are attracted to you, when people see you, that something different about you, when people see Jesus in you, the Lord then will add people to our midst. Amen? We don't have to hard sell and catch people by the throat. We don't have to do that. We don't have to argue people until they got no arguments. No, we don't have to do that. All we need to do is to be attractive. And the key to be attractive is arise and shine. Amen? Hallelujah. So church, 2017, the next couple of sermons will be all on beyond the walls, okay? In 2017, we want to be a church that goes beyond the walls. Amen? Let's all rise.